Divine Truth Spirit Assistance. Giving assistance to people who have lived on earth and who have now passed into the spirit world. In this recording titled Help for Spirit Steven Prestwich, musician from Cold Chisel, Steven Prestwich, a musician from the Australian band Cold Chisel, who died from a brain tumour, had been insistent with Mary during the previous day to communicate, and Jesus discusses with Steven the purpose of life, relationships, and details about his emotional condition. Recorded on the 19th of December 2018 from 11 a.m. in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. Session 1.
Well, hi everyone. It's Mary here. I'm here with Jesus.
Hey, Helen. How are you?
Good. How are you going?
I haven't seen you again this morning.
I know. We have these whirlwind sort of work weeks and we have so much to do, and then it's time to do filming, and so we just arrive and look at each other.
Yeah, that's right.
Anyway, today we're going to try some channeling. And to give you a little bit of background about who it is that I'm hopeful to channel today is a man called Steven Prestwich. And it's a little bit of a strange story as to how how this came to be. Yesterday we did some channeling as well, and as we were sitting down here in the studio, I had a song come to me very strongly. Actually, it had started in the morning, and it's a song by it's a very well-known Australian band, but I don't think Cold Chisel is the name, and I don't think they achieved much global fame, but they're certainly very well known here, and the song is called When the War is Over by Cold Chisel. And so that was going through my head, and I like the song, but I'm not a huge Cold Chisel fan, but I really appreciate their music. And this continued, and it continued till last night, and last night I looked it up on YouTube and showed Jesus the song, and we both enjoyed the song, and I thought, okay, well, that's the end of that. And then this morning, just as I was preparing our breakfast, the same song and another Cold Chisel song came into my head, and I thought, okay, something's going on here. Perhaps I shouldn't just ignore this. I'm very hesitant to channel famous people or people who are well known, because I take mediumship very seriously, and I would really hate to give a false impression to anyone ever through my mediumship. And when a person is very well known and they still have family on earth and I haven't known them, I do feel a bit of trepidation. But nonetheless, I'm trusting that my guides, Rachel, my guide predominantly, has got this in hand. So I went and looked up on the internet, and sure enough, the writer of the song actually passed away in 2011, and his name is Steven. And so I sat with that for a while, and he began to come through much more strongly. So I'm hopeful that we'll be able to assist him. He came asking for some help, so I'm hoping we'll be able to assist him this morning. Well, hello.
G'day, how are you?
Thanks for having me.
Pleased to meet you, Steven.
I'm told you can give me some answers.
Who told you that? Who's responsible for that?
Well, just some people that I met here where I am. And
How did you meet them? Do you mind explaining that a little?
Well, I guess I mean, I've got a lot of questions about what's going on.
Yeah. We'll get to those questions. That'll be fine. We'll give you plenty of time to answer that, and we'll answer those questions as you have them.
So I don't really know. I suppose just to say that I bumped into these people who said that I could get some answers. And then, I mean, I think I met Rachel. And and they said, if I come here, you might be able to talk to me about things.
Yeah. So, Stephen, let's just get a little bit of background first, just for the sake of anybody who listens to a channeling as well, but also for my sake as well, because I don't know much about your life. And so you're obviously a musician and a writer, a songwriter?
Yeah.
Yeah. And did you do that most of your life or, yep?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
I.
And how long were you associated with Cold Chisel?
While the band was together, the whole time.
Yeah. And were there a number of writers in the band? Like,
we all wrote.
And, you all wrote, yeah. And all pretty good voices too, by the sounds.
We like to think so.
Yeah, I think so. So you felt like you had a fairly full life on Earth? But it was sort of cut short.
Yeah, mate. I reckon I had a good life. I always considered myself a muso first and foremost, as sort of in my blood, I suppose, and how I saw myself. It's like it was never a job, it was just my love.
Yeah.
And
the ideal job, isn't
yeah
it?
I guess my problem, well, my sense though, is that I just felt like I was starting to get life figured out more than anything. And mm-hmm. And so while you asked was it a full life, I feel like I wanted more. I was just getting started. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know I wasn't young anymore, but there's so much more I wanted to do and I want to do.
Yeah.
And
you sort of feel that doing it on Earth would have been your ideal environment to do it? Is that the way you feel?
Well, yeah. I mean, I was in the guts of doing things, you know, and my kids, it's really important to me, my kids.
So you passed in 2011, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and from a quickly diagnosed brain tumour by the sounds, is that how it is?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So quick.
And
I wasn't ready.
Yeah, yeah. Sometimes it's like that, isn't it, when you know, some things get forced upon you in life and you sort of feel like I'm not really ready for that to happen, but...
And I want to be there now. I want to be there. I want to do the thing. I see my mates, I see my kids, and I just want to be there with them.
You don't mention your wife. Is that because you weren't married anymore or weren't living with the mother of your children?
I've been lucky with women.
When you say lucky, what does that mean?
My wife put up with a fair bit.
Yeah.
She let me have my loves.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't say a bad word about her now. I might have before, but I wouldn't now.
So she tolerated your shenanigans.
Well, I think as you get older, you see more about how you've been.
That's very true.
And, you know, like I said, I felt like I was just getting started and I wasn't young anymore, but...
sort of getting things figured out with your life as to what you wanted and what you wanted to do. And
you know, where I'd gone wrong a lot of times.
Yeah. And your children, how old were they when you passed? Are they pretty young still?
Although they weren't babies. They were, you know, they were on their way already.
Yeah.
But man, you got kids, don't you? Like
yeah.
you love them and you want to know them, and I feel like I didn't spend enough time with them. And I see what they're doing now, and I want to be a part of it with them. And there's so many things I've thought about and. That I didn't say and that I learned and I didn't pass on. I mean, there's lots that I tried to, but just feels like it's It's a waste. Why did I have to go now?
I suppose there's a lot. It sounds like you've got quite a number of different kinds of questions.
Yeah,
And
I've
so,
got a lot.
yeah, so perhaps what we need to do is sort of look at your sort of most pressing questions first, if we can. But we may have to provide a little bit of background for you to help you understand your new environment. It's sort of like going from Australia to a different country, in a lot of ways. But you got the ability to be in a different environment. But at this stage, it sounds to me like you are most of the time around the earth and checking up on your children, seeing where they're at. Is that how it is?
Yeah.
And still checking up on your mates as well, in terms of what's going on with the band or what, with the
Yeah.
guys that were in the band.
Yeah. And my own friends and I wanted to make music. I want to keep making music. It's my heart, you know.
Well, that's the first thing I'd probably like to say is just because you've passed from the earth, it doesn't mean you have to stop making music. There's, obviously music, just like any other like pure desire that exists within humanity, continues after passing. So, if you want, we can bring a few people to you who have been musicians on earth and then passed, and then and you can look at what they are currently doing, and some of their music would probably quite impress you, actually. So it's not that you've got to stop doing that. The key is to answer some of your questions about your life where you are now, and also look at some of the desires that you have and how you can best engage them, but also to help you understand where you live now and how things work.
Yeah, because probably my biggest question, I'm sad, I'm sad about dying and I'm sad, like I know it happened and but now, I've got this time and I'm looking at things and I just want to know what is it, what's it all mean? What's it all mean? What's the reason? What's the purpose for this whole thing?
Well, let's first start with a bit of background after you've passed, in terms of what's happened to you from the time from 2011 till now. So it's nearly a period of 7 years on Earth. What happened when you first passed? Can you remember the time when you first passed clearly?
It's a haze. It's a haze. I remember, oh, just devastated, just devastated and felt out of my control and I felt like that was it for me, that was it and
Like a sort of like the end of your life, and you had no future after that
yeah,
point.
and I couldn't do the stuff, and all the projects and so much we were working on, and I just felt. Then I just watched the grief, and I felt.
You mean the grief of others?
Yeah. And I couldn't do anything. I didn't know what to do. I just wanted to hold my kids a lot.
Because they were the ones who mostly felt the grief that you could see.
Oh, I don't know. I reckon a fair few people, yeah.
Some who didn't know you personally, but others who knew you personally, and
Yeah, and we've all got egos, but we got a lot of nostalgia as well, hey.
no,
So
that's true.
a lot of my muso mates, there was a lot of nostalgia, stirred up and I wanted so much to just be a part of it, be a part of all of everything.
All right. Well, in that first few years, It sounds to me like you spent a lot of time around the earth and watched what was going on.
Yeah, that's all I've been doing.
And you say you've been sad, but did you do much crying of your own? Or did you just feel sad without actually crying?
No, I mean,
Because most Aussie blokes, are not very good at crying, are we?
and I'm English, and I'm English as well, so come
You got a
on.
double whammy there.
Yeah, crying. Well, yeah, crying's the last thing you really think of, but I.
The reason why I raise the issue of crying is because of this. Emotions that you store inside of you carry around with you. They never leave you. But if you can let them out by experiencing them, they leave you. And that's a very important first lesson about, life, really. It's a lesson that you didn't really know much about on Earth, but it is a very important lesson that if you carry around your like storing your emotions, particularly your sadness, your grief, any shame that you might have, and all those kind of things, and you store those things within you, what happens is that it influences the choices and decisions you make for the rest of your life. And so really, firstly, the sadness that you feel has to be let you have to let go of it. So that's number one. And I know that sounds like some psychological stuff that you're probably not that used to, but the reality is there's some basic reasons why that's the case, and I'd like to sort of describe why that works. Is that all right?
Yeah,
Because one of the reasons why you're sort of quite locked up for the last 7 or 8 years in the same place is because you're not letting yourself grieve what you've lost or what you believe you've lost. See, a lot of your grief is actually associated with your beliefs. You believe you've lost the ability to interact. You believe you've lost the ability to create. You've believed you've lost a number of your children and your relationship with them, and you believe you've lost a lot of these things. And that's different to whether that's true or not. It's just your current set of beliefs. You can't see there being any alternative to those beliefs, and so you retain them. Does that make sense? But those beliefs do drive and are driven by some of this grief. You hold on to the belief because of some of the grief, and then also the belief itself generates some grief of its own, because anything that's not true actually finishes up generating more grief. So what I'm suggesting to you is, while you have those particular beliefs, they are not actually true, but they are what you firmly believe to be true. And how do you get from one point of seeing them as true to the other point of seeing them, well, they're only a feeling I have. And the way to do that is to actually feel them as feelings. Then they leave you, and then you get to see a bigger picture. A lot of what you'll be going through from now on will be about confronting beliefs. Does that make sense to you? Because see, most people, when you're on Earth, what were your beliefs about an afterlife on Earth? Did you have any belief in an afterlife?
I didn't really think a lot about it,
Yeah,
really.
most people don't, in Australia in particular.
I mean, maybe I had some relics in there.
So you thought possible, it might be possible, but it's not something that you really considered.
See, this is really what I want to talk to you about. Like, what is this reality? What is this reality I'm in? Where am I and what's going on?
Well,
And what
there's a
is the purpose of it all if I'm here now and I can see them all and I can kind of be around, but I can't be there? And why not? And what's the point?
Yeah, no, they're all good questions, and they all have answers. So that's what I'd like to go through the answers step by step with you a bit, though, because sometimes you need to build on a bit of a foundation first. So let's do that, eh? So let's look at the first thing. You didn't conceive yourself to be a person. You didn't have a strong conception of what you would be after you passed.
No.
So you're sort of very tied into the physical body, physical life, life on Earth, without there being much consideration for the future, like if there was even a future life, because you felt it was unknown and not really able to be predicted, you didn't give it much time to think about. And also, you were pretty involved in your life on Earth because you had your desires and you had your passions. And you followed your passions and desires a lot. And so that when somebody's in their passions and desires frequently, they also don't think about their future life. You know, they're so involved in their current life, you know, and enjoying their current life.
Yeah, I mean that's me. That I lived for the music pretty much, and I considered myself an artist on every level, really.
But one thing about being an artist oftentimes is we don't think much about others in the sense of think much about giving to others. A lot of times it's about doing our art and enjoying our art and enjoying our life, but there's sort of not much about really loving others in a lot of ways, is there?
Well, and I mean, I've had time to think about that too more, but I really, I felt like I was loving people through the music.
Yeah, no, well, because you're a passionate, that is one way you can love people, obviously.
And you talk about pain and sorrow and these weren't alien to me. It came through in my art, and I know sadness,
I know you know sadness, but you don't experience sadness to the point where you let it go. And that's what I'm getting at.
Yeah,
You
right.
have almost a nostalgic feeling about sadness, where you sort of hold it close to yourself and you don't really let it go.
Well, in a lot of ways, it makes us who we are, doesn't it?
No, it doesn't have to. Unfortunately, it does for most people make them who they are while they're living on Earth, because there's a build-up of sadness inside of a person while during their life on Earth. And then, as that build-up of sadness, finishes up to ending their life generally, and then in their life in the spirit world, right at the beginning, there's also a lot of sadness generally because you feel like the sense of loss and a loss of your life and things like that. So there's extra sadness there, but instead of experiencing it, which is the only way to let it go, what we end up doing is storing it, and then using it to define our nature, our personality. But it's not really our nature and personality, it's sadness being expressed. So the key is to let it go, and that requires crying. Men were given tear ducts, just like women were given tear ducts, and there's a good reason for that, because we build up a lot of sadness in our life, and usually through choices we make, but also sometimes through the choices others make,
I
and we
mean,
got to let it go.
you asked before about crying, and I mean, I have cried here. I mean, I've cried, and I cried on Earth, sometimes. Like,
But not it's not something where you're still store what I'm suggesting to you is you're still storing a lot of sadness. So
yeah, and this thing you said about beliefs, I'll have to give that a lot more thought.
you don't believe that letting go of sadness would make you feel happier. You feel that letting go or experience sadness will make you feel sadder. But that's not how it actually works. That's not the way it was created to be. So we just need to talk about a few fundamental facts about life in the spirit world for you to contemplate. And I'm happy for you to come back again, even after you've had a bit of a thought, think about those things, and we talk again about where you can go from there, type of thing. But let's look at some basic fundamental principles first. You have a physical body when you're on Earth that you could touch. Yes? Now you're in the spirit world. People on Earth can't touch you,
No, or see me.
or see you, but you can see your own physical body and you can touch it. So the body is, and your body is very similar looking, isn't it, to the way it was looking on Earth? So very similar. Looks, same sort of age almost. Looks very similar. You can recognize yourself if you looked in the mirror, but you probably in the last 8 years haven't even looked in the mirror. Is that right?
No, I was never much for mirrors anyway.
Exactly. Well, I suppose most Aussie blokes are sort of not much for mirrors anyway. But yeah, you know, you probably have an opportunity to look in the mirror, but sometimes it's good to just check it out and just see where you're at, you know what I mean? See how you look, how other people see you, you know. Do you want to do that?
Yeah.
Is there anything you notice?
Well, I know it's me.
Yeah. Can you see there's certain parts of your body that look like they're hurt?
Yeah.
That they need to get fixed up?
Yeah.
You see that?
Yeah.
And that is because of different emotions that you're storing. Now, the question then becomes, okay, I've now got this spirit body, but is that me? Or is there something beyond that that's me?
Yeah, and this is where
your physical body was you, didn't you?
Look, I've talked to a lot of people.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah.
You know, I haven't been. You know, I've been talking.
Yeah.
And this nature of reality thing, you know, what is real and what is, you know, I don't know. It's like, I thought about this on Earth, you know, it wasn't like I was like, that's it, there's nothing spiritual.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I knew there was, well, I didn't know, you know. And
well, most people who are connected to some music and connected to desires do feel there's more to life than just what's on Earth. Most people do.
And the feeling, you know, there's feeling you feel at a live gig, and there's, you know, there's things that you know are beyond
the physical that are happening. Yeah. So at a live gig, you're getting all this emotion from the audience, aren't you, that you interact with, and it sort of changes how you feel and how you express
your
emotion.
It's a rush.
It's a rush. And I can see why a lot of performers get quite addicted to that, right? And so you end up with this sort of emotional highs that happen as a result of what's coming at you and what's going. So obviously there's a lot of things going on that were invisible, but tangible.
Yeah, it changed a lot. I mean, you know, as a young guy, I wanted like a lot of that. And then as you mature, you know, there's a maturity that comes.
Realizing.
In your performing and in the interaction as well, you know.
Yeah.
You become a man rather than just a boy, I suppose.
Rather than a boy just looking for his next fix, you become a man who's a bit more mature than that and understands.
I like to think so.
I like things a bit better than that. Yes, but what I'm getting at is that in your, you know, when you're on Earth, you believed it, you were just a physical body mostly. You could obviously feel and sense a lot of other things going on, but the way you lived your life was very physical, right? In a lot of ways.
Yeah. And that, you know, that's the thing. Like, I've been told I can leave where I am, right?
Yeah, you can.
But I don't really want to.
Of course.
Because
there's attractions here.
Well, yeah, you know.
There's things you want to see what's going on and you want to know what's happening and, you know, you believe that you're not, if you leave, you're not going to be able to come back. That's another false belief, but it's a belief you have.
Yeah, and I, you know, there's a certain level of connection with my kids right now, and I want that, and I want the connection to the music, and I've figured out ways, you know, that I can influence things and, you know, just be a part of that music making sometimes, and I don't want to lose that.
Yeah, and this is what I'm saying. That's also a false belief, that you're going to lose that. The issue, there's a number of false beliefs you have about life that as you've been living it in the last 8 years because of being in what sort of we'd talk say is what is the earthbound condition. And what that basically means is as a spirit, you've passed, but you're still very much involved with life on Earth. You really would like to still be living on Earth. You're very much involved with life on Earth and the people on Earth and the kinds of things you were doing on Earth. And so you really just want to stay on Earth, but there are certain problems you're now facing with that cause bits of grief for you because you can't have that full engaged interaction with people who are not as sensitive about your presence as they could be.
Yeah.
Make sense?
Yeah. And I feel...
And so it starts to feel frustrating and disappointing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's a normal process that many people go through who pass.
Right.
Does that make sense?
So this isn't kind of forever.
No, well, let's look at things logically, right? If there is an infinite universe out there, then you have infinite future possibilities. And maybe what you're doing is restricting all of your possibilities to the Earth life without considering the infinite and maybe more enjoyable possibilities that exist beyond that. So that's one thing.
I just can't imagine going. I can't imagine it.
No, because that's because you're tied to your sadness about it. And this is what I'm saying. You're emotionally tied to the Earth life because the sadness is tying you to it. And it's tying you down to your belief systems. You follow? It's sort of like on Earth, if you think about it, if you believed that you could never play a guitar, would you ever play a guitar?
No.
You wouldn't, would you?
Well, yeah.
You wouldn't do it because you just believed you can't. But as a muso know, you can pick up a lot of instruments, right? But you have to believe right at the beginning, you have to have some faith right at the beginning that you can actually become proficient at it before you're going to do it, right?
Yeah.
Yep. And this is what you're facing with regard to your spirit life now. You're basically, because there's no formulated beliefs or understanding about your future and the possibilities, which are amazingly endless and beautiful, but you just don't know that, right? You feel tied to what you believe you've lost on Earth, and you're still trying to involve yourself in the life of people on Earth, but you don't even understand by doing that that you're affecting their life in the future when they pass, and how you can help them to embrace the life in this that you are yet to embrace. You follow me? There's a whole heap of possibilities you haven't considered because you haven't believed in any of these things and you don't know about them. So it's like a guy who picks up a guitar, looks at it and goes, what the hell's that thing? You know, I don't know what to do with that, and puts it away.
Mm.
And that's really what you're doing with the spirit life. You're picking it up and going, because you're in it now.
Mm.
You're picking it up and you're going, oh, what do I do with that? I don't know anything about it. I'll put that away and I'll focus my attention on this physical life still. But you could be, if you think about possibilities, you could be precluding yourself from a lot of happiness and a lot of joy and a lot of interesting things in your life that actually also allow you to still communicate and still interact with people on Earth.
Yeah, I'd like that.
But in a different way than you have been. Because the way you have been is by being driven by your sadness. Your sadness is affecting your decision-making process is about leaving and finding out new things. Now, if you think about it on Earth, when you found new things and you did new things, that's brought a lot of joy, right?
Yeah.
But now what you've done for the last 8 years or so is you're not doing new things. So that's going to preclude you from experiencing a lot of joy. You follow? So this is the conundrum you have. You're facing this sort of difficulty because you've still got a lot of sadness in you about your Earth life and missing your Earth life and missing your children and missing the process of your creation because you were so involved in that life and you were passionate about it.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, and also as a result of not having any firm beliefs about what an afterlife would constitute, you now believe those things are not possible for your future, and you keep wanting to come back to Earth to continue these particular things that brought you joy.
Yeah.
Without understanding, and unfortunately, it's just bringing you some more sorrow because you can't really fully fulfill them. Nothing really feels satisfying. And so it's actually bringing you more sorrow than actually more joy. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. And this is why I say you can allow yourself to let that sorrow go by just having a good ball about, you know what I mean? Just like, you know what it's like to embrace life when you're on earth. You embraced a lot of your life with passion. Well, you got this sorrow, embrace it with some passion and just let yourself feel it. That's the first thing that I feel will help you. Make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. But what we need to do is talk to you a bit about what possibilities there are, right, for your life from now on. Because we need to help you see that your current belief systems are not formulated about your life as you're living it now. They are still belief systems, you know, connecting you back to your earth life, but you don't see the infinite possibilities of your future life. So that's an issue as well. The third thing I'd like to talk to you a bit about is about some philosophy, or what you could call spiritual philosophy, about existence, God, how you know, what constitutes a human being, those kind of things. We probably want to talk about that a bit as well. Just to answer some of those very basic questions that you've had, which when you think about it, most people on earth have, but they just shut themselves down to answer them because they don't really believe that you can answer them, right? So it's okay to stay connected to this sadness, and particularly after we have our conversation, my suggestion is get yourself an environment where, you know, you don't have to worry about who's around, you know, go to a place that's nice and private where you can just have a good ball about the sadness you feel and just let it out, and it will relieve you of this bind that you feel you're in and this dissatisfaction that you feel.
But I mean, my sadness is binding me to my kids and I feel it. I don't want to lose them.
It's not your, if you think about it, using sadness as a bind to your children is not really love binding you to your children. The sadness is about what you believe you've lost.
Yeah, okay.
So there's a difference between the sadness that you feel about not being with your children and going through that compared to having love for your children. And letting yourself experience that.
Yeah, okay.
And what you're doing is you're thinking, as you did a lot about on earth with your other sadnesses, you felt that your sadness makes up the purity of the love.
Yeah.
And it doesn't. And this is one of the false beliefs you retain that most people who pass from earth retain. It's particularly for the first few years after their passing.
Okay.
Yeah. So don't confuse your sadness with your relationship.
Okay.
All right? Your sadness is your sadness. It can be released. That will not do anything else other than improve your relationship with your children. If you think about your children now, your sadness at times, you can see that it does do this. When you're with them, your sadness infects them. Can you see that? Sometimes when you're with them?
Yeah.
Sometimes when you're with them, you come to them, they're fairly happy, and then you're with them a bit, and all of a sudden they start feeling sad like you are. Do you see what I'm saying? That's not good for them, nor is it good for you.
I thought, well, yeah.
That's not love.
Yeah, I thought I was loving them.
No, love is a joyful and desire-based giving. You know, love is a feeling of joy and wonder in something,
which you have. I feel proud of them.
Yeah. So that's sort of more of a loving feeling. Do you see what I'm saying? Whereas this sadness, this nostalgic sadness that you have with them, that's not loving them really. And that's also infecting them. You can see when you go to them and they can feel your sadness, they're sensitive to you, yeah? They can feel your sadness. They start feeling sad themselves.
Yeah.
You know, that's not a good thing for them either. This is what I'm saying is that, see, most of us, most people on earth, and let's say in this case, most guys in particular, don't own their own sadness. You know, what I mean by owning your own sadness is fully experiencing your own sadness as an experience, you know, What we do, what most of us do, is we project our sadness on the world around us. We want the world around us to be involved in our sadness. And from what I could see from the creation of some of the music that you created, there was that sort of motivation a bit in there with the music sometimes, to feel the sadness and the frustration and the different emotions that people had, and to express that, which is good. It connects them to those feelings, but they're not actually feeling it. What they're doing is they're feeling justified to hold on to it as a nostalgic thing that defines them. And this is unfortunately one of the negative powers of music on earth. You can create music to actually cause people to stay in sadness rather than experience their sadness. Now, you know, that's something that I feel you'll learn how to do, you know, create music that helps people go through their stuff rather than storing their stuff. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. And what you've done is you've stored your sadness, and now every time you go to earth and you're with some of your mates or you're with some, you know, children, they, if they are connected to you in any way, they're going to feel some of this sadness that you have. And so when you're around, sometimes they'll feel sadder. And you can see that happening. And you know that's happened. So you can see, and what I'm suggesting to you is that's not what I would call a loving relationship. That's a sharing of sadness.
Mm.
A loving relationship would actually be to own and feel my own sadness. And then when I go to the person, they are not, you know, I can help them feel their sadness and be happier, which is obviously going to be a more loving thing to do. So that's the first thing I wanted to talk about was the reason why you feel so bound. And it's also been the reason why you don't want to discover what's around you fully. Because you're afraid that if you discover more, then you'll feel drawn towards those things. Right? Mm, and then you might feel like you're going to lose more of your connection to Earth and the people on Earth, and that makes you feel sad. So in a way, finding out more truth about where you live is in a way like something that you'd prefer to prevent at this stage.
Mm.
Because all it does, all you feel because of your belief systems at the moment, all you feel is that that's just going to make me more sad.
Yeah.
You know, when that might not be true, right? You don't even know if it's true. It's just a presumption, really.
Yeah.
Yep. So let's look at how you're made. So now you know you've got a spirit body, right? So diet body you can now touch, but people on earth can't touch it, obviously.
Mm.
You can have feelings sometimes from people when you brush past them, can't you, on earth and stuff? But they feel more like sort of emotions and sensations in you rather than actual physical sense of touch. But if another spirit comes and holds your hand, it's a solid touch, isn't it? Yeah, completely different. But the other part is that you are a soul as well. The soul is actually what stores everything and controls the bodies. So you could say that your bodies were really just sort of like robots that your soul controls. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. So your soul, and you are actually only one half of one soul.
Right.
The other half is called your soul mate, right? And given the fact that you were attracted to women when you're on earth, is that correct?
Yeah.
Yep. And your soulmate is highly likely going to be a woman, right? And she's the other half of your soul. And half of the soul went to and attached itself to your body and your spirit body. And when it incarnated at school, the other half went to a woman body and a woman spirit body. Right? So that's your soulmate, whoever that is. I don't know if you know who that is at this stage. I don't feel you do know who that is. And you'll probably have to develop some of these emotions that I'm talking about first to actually know.
Yeah, I think you missed some of my humour earlier when I said I was lucky with women. You know, I see things in hindsight where, I don't know, there was... Yeah. Anyway.
You're having a bit of a
Well, you see things from different perspectives and you realize what a bastard you've been sometimes.
Yeah.
But yeah.
And that makes you feel bad about your relationship with women now. And so that's one reason why you haven't considered that either, because there's sadness to deal with there, right?
Right.
And so everywhere there's sadness to deal with, but we don't want to deal with it. What do with it? We just avoid it. And in some ways, your relationship with your children is in some ways a bit of an avoidance of your relationship with your other half.
Right.
You know what I mean? And dealing with some of the issues regarding, the other half of yourself, like, and in particular, dealing with issues re relating to women generally.
Okay.
Yeah. So these are all things that you'll learn as you go on, right? But what I'm getting at is you have a physical body, you've got a spirit body, and then you've got the soul that connects to that. Your soul is the container of your thoughts. All of your thoughts come from there, and the container of all of your emotions. All of your memories, all of your history, all of your life is all contained within the soul. Now, just to give you a bit of a sort of a scientific experiment, just a quick one, what I'm going to do is ask Rachel to come to you, right? And she can just read just a few things from your soul that you may not have remembered, but are still stored there. So I'll get her to tell you them.
Well, I mean, she's telling me about the day I was born. I can't remember it.
Of course, but it's stored in your soul. She's reading it from your soul.
Huh.
You've got the capacity to read it from your own soul too, but most people don't because they, don't even think of doing it, of course.
So, like, what is this? Is it like boxes inside of boxes? It's like I'm now in some kind of parallel world where I was on Earth and now I'm not, and but I'm, it's like I'm still kind of, I don't get it.
Well, let me explain
And
it a
this
bit.
soul thing, is that like another parallel thing that I've got to one day be there, or like, is it
Yeah,
always separation? What's going on?
so they are all interesting questions. As you can see, the more answers you get, the more questions.
Yeah.
The more questions you have. Yeah,
Yeah.
that's but that's a bit like music too, isn't it? Like in a lot of
Yeah.
ways. It's
Yeah.
like any form of endeavor, the more answers you get, the more you question. But if we go back to the fundamentals, that they're all good questions, and we'll try to answer some of them. The fundamentals are when the soul used to existed when it was first created in an unidentified form. In other words, it didn't know itself. It wasn't self-conscious. And it needed the earth experience because this is answering your question about why did we go to earth in the first place. We need the earth experience in order to become conscious of ourselves. The soul is not conscious of itself before it incarnates. And the way it becomes conscious of itself is by having experiences. So initially the soul is being created, and there is a God that created these souls. The soul is created. And the soul has to have an experience in order to know itself. And the first experience that you could say the childhood of our experience is this incarnation process where two bodies are created when mum and dad had sex. There's a physical body created and a spirit body created. And the half of the soul connects to those bodies and controls them from now on.
Okay.
Does that make sense? And it needs to happen so that you can understand yourself. That's the very first reason why it has to happen. So you could say that one of the main purposes for life is so that you can come to fully understand yourself. Now, on Earth, you were particularly interested in understanding your profession or your passion, but you didn't have a high desire to understand yourself. By the time you got to your 50s, just before you passed, you understood more of yourself
Yeah.
than you did when you were in your 20s or your teens,
Yeah.
right? But from our discussion now that we're having, you can see you still didn't understand about the sadness and how it was binding to you. So you didn't understand that about yourself.
No.
So there's things you still don't see about yourself. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And one of the keys of life, one of the beautiful things about life is that we come to understand ourselves fully if we continue to grow. And growth doesn't stop on earth.
Yeah, because why? It feels like it was cut short for
no,
me.
No, well, that's only a belief.
Right.
And this is what you've got to remember, that you feel like it was cut short, and there's grief associated with your earth life, and there's grief associated with the ideas and concepts that I'm now missing out on what I was really getting. I was really getting my life together.
Yeah.
And I'm now missing out on that. But the reality is that, you know, those are just beliefs. They're not true. They're just concepts that you currently have, right?
Mm.
That can be challenged, just like any belief can be challenged. Right. So this reason why I'm describing this sort of process, which goes on for everybody, is they have every soul must incarnate. And the way that it incarnates is that it splits in two. And one half has attractions to the body that matches its nature, its sexual nature. So in your case, that's a male nature.
Right.
So you've got a body, a male body and a male spirit body. And in the case of your soulmate, it's attracted to the female body, female nature, attracted to the female body. So when the child was conceived in the womb, there was this automatic attraction going on without your choice being involved. It's an automatic process that has to happen so that you can start to become aware of yourself. That's the first thing. So the process of incarnation, the reason why we lived on Earth, is to start the process of becoming aware of ourselves.
Right.
That's the purpose of it. One purpose. There's many others, but that's a primary purpose. Make sense? And you can see that in your early adulthood, you didn't know much about yourself really, but by the time you hit 50, you're starting to know a bit more about yourself and more about your likes and more about your dislikes and more about what you did right and what you did wrong. And so your experience helped you come to know yourself.
So all the stuff, all the people, all the things, all the places, all the stuff of life, it's just what there to show you about
It's helping
yourself.
You come to understand yourself and what your passions are and what your desires are and what you like doing and what you don't like doing and what your nature is and what your personality is like. And, you know, and unfortunately on Earth, though, we also get a whole heap of crap with it, like sadness and grief and shame and other emotions because of choices we make that are mixed up in it. And so sometimes we can't tell the difference between those things, which are just emotions we have to feel, and what is our true nature and our, you know, and our personality. And that's how you are at the moment. You're confused a bit because you believe that your sadness is a part of your personality. And what I'm suggesting to you is that it's not. It's just sadness that you can let go of. Make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so the very first purpose, that was the first reason why God created this process, is because he wants all of us to discover ourselves. That's an important process of life. And you come to discover your joys and your you know, personality, your nature, what, you know, your likes and your dislikes and all those kind of things. And you do that through having experiences. So the more experiences a person has, the more they discover about themselves, which is great. But if a person has very restricted experiences on Earth, unfortunately, they don't discover much about themselves on Earth.
Mm.
So some people that you might have met in your life on Earth, it's like they barely knew themselves, right? And that's because oftentimes their experiences were restricted. They weren't maybe very self-reflective. Mm. And, you know, so they never really discovered much about themselves. So when they pass, they'll find it even more difficult than yourself because they, you know, have yet to really work through why they don't want to discover anything about themselves.
Right.
Yeah. But that's the first purpose. The second purpose is to discover the universe you live in. So really God's created this universe, which you could think of as a playground for the soul, right? And the beauty of the playground is that there are it's a framework, you could think of it as. It's a framework of physical things, but also laws that govern those physical things, right? To help the soul develop and grow and be safe. You follow? So while the physical body can die, the spirit body, well, people are unsure a bit about whether that can die or not, but the soul itself, highly unlikely it can die. So you'll keep discovering new things all of your life. The rest of your existence is going to be a process of discovery, and that's going to continue potentially infinitely. Right? So life doesn't have an end. It can be a continuous process of growth. So that's the second thing. Use the universe, not just your concept of the restricted universe. Use the whole universe to discover more about life and what's available to you and the joys and satisfactions that are available in those areas of life. You've yet to engage because you're still thinking in the restricted view of the earth because your sadness ties you to the earth.
It's mind-blowing, isn't it?
The third reason why God created us was regarding potentials. And this, what I mean by that is the potential to actually have a relationship with God. So that's also available to you. And it's not the same as what you would have heard about it religiously on earth, you know. It's like God's an individual that exists outside of the universe that he created, and we have the ability to have an emotional transaction with God. We can find things about from God about our life, and we can also give feelings and thoughts to God, just like you'd have a relationship with any other person. Right. Now, what I'd like to do is another experiment with that. Do you want to try an experiment with that?
Sure.
Okay. And this one's going to be a bit of a tough experiment. Any challenging thing is, right? You've already gone through some of your feelings about how you treated women on Earth, haven't you?
Well, I don't know.
Well, you're aware that you weren't always a great guy to women, right?
Yeah.
And sometimes you use them and so forth rather than love them properly, in a caring manner,
Yeah.
caring about their feelings,
Yeah.
So let's there's a thing inside of the soul called the conscience. It's a mechanism that allows God to tell you direct truth if you ask the question. You've got to ask the question though, right?
Okay.
So you could ask the question, what is God's opinion of the way I treated women?
Sort of start to have this sense that it's pretty complex.
Very complicated. Most people on Earth are very complicated when it comes to relationships.
Beyond what I've thought about.
Exactly. Yeah. See, God knows everything about you. So God can share anything with you. God also knows everything about the universe. So God can actually share anything about the universe with you too. So here's another question that doesn't involve you, right? Ask God, are there different locations in the spirit world that are better than Earth?
Yeah.
In terms of happier and more loving.
Yeah, it's pretty challenging though, isn't it? Yeah.
But you can see how simple it is with the conscience. You can just go ask a question, get an answer, ask a question, get an answer. It's just how brave you are about your questions, right?
Yeah.
Most of us think we're pretty brave, but when it comes to asking questions or challenges, we're not that brave, right?
I think I need to have a rest. Yeah.
But can I just summarize what I've said to you so far?
Yeah.
Is that all right?
Yeah.
Basically, what I've said to you so far in answer to your question, because the real question you had, the reason why you came to us at first was, why am I here? What's the purpose of life?
Yeah.
Can you see I've listed three main answers for that?
Yeah, and I just it's probably beyond what I thought I was gonna hear, so I've gotta
Well, there's a fourth answer I'd like to give you too, if that's all right. Another reason why you're here and other people are here is God wants us to have relationships.
Right.
He wants us to establish...
Well, that I understand.
Yeah, well, you can see in your own life on earth, right, that happens, yep. And you can see that. He wants us to have relationships because relationships help us figure out the first three things. Make sense?
Why didn't it work?
But we have the potential of having a relationship with God. Now, I've only shown you half of that. That's part of that's called the conscience, and the other part's called the love-based relationship with God, which is a really beautiful experience that it's worth experimenting with.
Okay.
All right? And it's quite simple to experiment with that. All you've got to do is ask God how God feels about you.
What now?
Yeah.
Oh.
Why not?
Oh, I don't know. I'm a bit overwhelmed, frankly.
Well, this will probably overwhelm you too, but get used to being overwhelmed, mate. You know what I mean? Being overwhelmed is a good thing because it means you're learning new things.
Yeah, wow. I can't probably. I don't know. I don't want to talk about that now.
Yeah. Can you see you want to stop it?
Yeah.
And the reason why is that sadness comes up.
Yeah.
And it just makes you feel even more like you need to have a good ball, right?
Yeah.
And this is what I'm saying. When you do go away, my suggestion is let yourself do that and let the love that comes from God trigger it. You know what I mean? Because it can help a lot. It can really like soften you up to it and help you just, you know, passionately go into it rather than avoid it. You follow?
Yeah.
But in summary, the main reason why you were here on Earth was so that you could become self-aware. You become come to know who you are. And you did that a bit, but not fully.
Right? Yeah.
But your life continues now and you've still got the opportunity to do all that. We haven't talked about the possibilities of your future life yet. We haven't talked about possibility of different locations or anything like that.
No.
But they're all obvious. Obviously, they must be there because you just asked God whether they're there and he said, yes, they are. So they must be there. You ask Rachel where she comes from.
Yeah, somewhere not here. I mean, people have told me there's other places.
So she didn't come from the earthbound condition, but she lived on earth, didn't she? How long ago did she live on earth?
Ages ago. Yeah, a long time ago.
Yeah. She's had to go through the same experience that you're now going through of becoming aware of yourself more and more and more, working out how you fit into this playground of the universe. And also she has had this relationship with God. She developed her conscience and this love-based relationship with God, and that helped her a lot to work through these things. She had to let go of some grief. She had some grief when she was on Earth. What was she like on Earth? Let her tell a bit about that.
Yeah, wow. Yeah, wow. Wow. Pretty amazing life.
Yeah. Traumatic too.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways, right? So she had sadness to let go of too, just like you, more than you, more sadness than you had to let go of.
I'm saying, yeah, it's
And how is she now? She like...
Yeah, pretty...
pretty happy, eh?
Over it, yeah.
Yeah. And she's not over it because of just trying to suppress it. She's not over it by maintaining the nostalgia of it. She's over it by actually... working through it by feeling it.
Yeah. I wouldn't have believed that that's her life.
Yeah. Because you think when you meet a person with a life like that, you'd think they'd have a lot more sadness than what you've had, wouldn't you? And also almost horror in some places, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you'd think, they'd be pretty sad and angry, wouldn't you? But she's not like
Rightly
that now,
so.
is she?
No.
So
No,
she let it all
she's not.
go, and it doesn't and didn't wind her life anymore. Right? So that's a good illustration of finding life. Now if she can give you a picture of where she lives, because she can share a bit of a video image if you like.
Yeah, wow. That's pretty out there.
But hard to imagine a place like that, right?
Yeah.
And that even it exists, let alone that somebody can live there, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Sort of the stuff of science fiction, right?
Yeah.
Is what it
Yeah.
seems like when you
Yeah.
first see it,
It
right?
is.
And yet there are all possibilities, and this is the thing. If you stay bound to just thinking that your earth life was your only possibilities, you're going to severely limit your own happiness for your future. But not only are you going to limit your own happiness for your own future, you're going to also limit your happiness of every mate that you catch up with who comes from Earth, who wants to find out, well, where's my life now and what am I doing now? And you, if you went to them now in your current state, you would say, look, it's pretty bad, mate. You know, I wish we were all back on Earth, eh? That's probably what you'd say.
Yeah,
But if
I
you knew about the other stuff, do you think you'd say that? Probably
no.
not, right? And so can you see that if you move forward through an understanding and greater increase your understanding, your love for other people can also then help them to make or gain future understanding that will help them.
Yeah.
You can still do that through music, you can do that through your art. You know what I mean? It's all possible. You can still do all of that, but you'd want to do it, could you? Because at the end of the day, unless you move forward, how does somebody you help? How can they move forward? They can only move to where you are, right? So, you know, if you're one of your children passed today, right? You'd have be happy to see them, give them a hug, and all that kind of, but what can you tell them?
Yeah.
Not much more than. You can't tell them any more than what you currently know. You can't show them through experience like Rachel was doing with you, can you?
No.
So you can't do any of that. So there's good motivations, you see,
Yeah.
for going through this process of discovery of more things. So hopefully, Stephen, that's answered the fundamental question, you know, of why am I here and why, you know, what was it all for? And it's also helped you maybe see a bit about what's tying you to the earth life and also infecting the belief systems that you're having that's stopping you from exploring another alternative or other alternatives for your life. Right? And the last thing I'd like to say is the more you grow, the larger your ability to have relationships is. So if you think about that in how it applies to your children and your mates on earth, the more you grow as a person, the more you understand life, where you live, understand life, that you've got a better ability to love the people in your life than you had before. Right. So the more you grow, the more power you have. The more you grow, the more ability you have to share love. The more you grow, the more creative you will be. The more you grow, the better your life will be and more happier it will be. And the main reason why it hasn't been so happy since you've passed is because you feel like you've missed out on so much on Earth that you haven't grieved about, and that stopped you from considering a future life. And this happens all the time. So don't feel that you're any, like, it's not, you're not a unique case, you know? You're not fundamentally flawed or anything like that. It's just how it is for most people on Earth who haven't given much, there's not much knowledge on Earth about what life is like in the spirit world.
I've got to say, I'm not someone who's prone to thinking I'm very flawed.
Well, that's probably a good thing, but I'm sure you'll find some flaws from God's perspective. Because the happiness, what I've learned in my life is that happiness comes from understanding God's perspective and bringing my own life into more harmony with that perspective. That's also benefited my life to a large degree. It's increased my happiness to a large degree. And it's also increased my ability to have stronger relationships that are more satisfying as well. And so my suggestion is find out as much as you can about yourself from God and work through any issues or that you have about that. Don't stop yourself from doing that. Live your life, you know, on earth, you learnt how to live your life with passion, right? Live your life with passion now. Stop, don't be limited by the concept that you're now missing out on that. You know, you've got lots of new things to discover. It's like it's bigger than being in a new country because it's a whole new universe that you, so it's not a physical universe anymore. That it encompasses the physical universe. It's larger than the physical universe. And so there's lots and lots of things to discover, you can only discover them if you're driven. You know, you want the answers, you want to know. And as I said, your sadness is a lot of times pulling you back from wanting to know things.
Yeah, well, this didn't turn out how I expected.
What did you expect? Did you expect some sort of miracle?
I don't know. No. I didn't really know what to expect. I just thought you'd just give me some answers about the purpose of life. I wasn't prepared for all the stuff about me.
Yeah, but I have given you some answers about the purpose of life. And you can see that discovering the stuff about you is important for the purpose of life. Can you see the relationship? Like, without fully knowing what is in you at the moment is a combination of what I would classify as sadness, grief, shame, guilt, other emotions, along with some pure emotions of passion, love, joy, you know, desire for your music, all those things, pure emotions, right? And you've got your personality and your nature, but because there's these other things mixed in with it, what you haven't fully discovered who you are yet. You will if you get rid of all those things that are just things, really, they're like mud thrown at you. You know, your grief is like mud thrown at you. You can wash it off. But to wash it off, you're going to have to go through the experience, right? When you wash it off, then you will have a very clearer concept of yourself. You'll have the ability to have better relationships even that you have now, stronger relationships, more purely motivated. And you've got the possibility of having a relationship with God if you so choose. All these things are things that you didn't experience on earth, and a lot of those things will bring you even more joy than your music brought you on earth. Bearing in mind that you're still probably going to do your music, right? So, you know, the key is to open up your belief system enough to contemplate that things are not going to be as bad or as dire as you think they might be. Now, just at the end, what I'd like to do is, do you want to do a quick visit to the home you can be in?
Mate, I really want to go. Can I go?
Yeah, of course you can go. You can go.
I feel like all this pressure on me from both of you to stay, and I don't want to.
That's all right. That's all right. Yeah, you can go.
He might come back, but he'd had enough a fair
He
while ago.
needs to have a cry.
I
He's pretty sad, eh?
Yeah, and I, it was interesting. I felt the connection wax and wane a bit, but also I felt I'd received some very strong impressions from him before that once we got in this environment, there was less, he was, I don't know why, if it was an issue in me or an issue with speaking with you or the context, but he was less forthcoming, I suppose. And then
it's because he started. I could feel why he expected to have a conversation about things.
And he wanted to talk about his life on Earth very strongly. And I could feel when you were directing him to other things, he kept impressing on me, oh, no, I just talk about this. I want to talk about this. I want to talk about this. And, I guess that's the condition of a lot of earthbound spirits. They're very connected to their earth life and they...
Yeah, we, you know, the medium, when we've gone to mediumship sessions ourselves to other people's mediumship, it's very, very fundamentally basic, isn't it? Because... Yeah. Basically, the spirits are just really still wanting to live on Earth, still sharing in the lives of the people on Earth, still not wanting to move forward in their life of discovery.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, I could feel that very strongly from him. But my feeling was that, you know, he talked to us. There's an opportunity here try to hold him there as long as I can. And he wanted to go. That's fine. But I was going to wait till he said it before.
I find myself putting a bit of energy into keeping them there as well once they hit that point.
Yeah, you don't need to.
Where I'm sort of I'm reassuring them, it's okay to stay, it's okay to stay, it's okay to stay, but it gets a bit tense. And I felt his mood change quite a number of times as well, and I feel there's quite a lot of dry kind of wit or something in the man, and it was interesting. Anyway, Stephen, thanks for coming. And
it's good that he came for his own sake, really.
Yeah,
because he could have stayed in that state for much, much longer.
Yeah,
getting sadder and sadder.
Yeah,
not realizing that the more he stays in that state, the more dissatisfying his life's going to feel.
Yeah,
yeah. So I sort of feel for him a bit, because it's sort of like, He felt to me when he passed to be in his own mind, to be like sort of like he's gotten his life sort of sorted out now type of feeling, you know. And now he just wanted to enjoy what he'd sorted out.
Yeah.
And just, we didn't get to talk about the reason why he passed.
No.
Which was all about him suppressing a major problem that he had on Earth. So with his intellect, and so
using his intellect to suppress it. Yes.
Yes.
He did ask me that question,
but
this
I don't
morning,
think he would have.
I don't know if he would have been open to really discussing.
No,
that we would like to.
Yeah, I don't think he would have felt comfortable talking about the problem openly. So we didn't get really the opportunity to discuss that particular issue. But I'm sure if he makes some of the other progresses that he has, then. Yeah. That he could make, then he'll probably ask the question and get the answer pretty quickly.
And we can talk to him again, and even talk to him in private as well.
Yeah, we'll probably have a few conversations in private, I'd say.
Yeah.
Because I doubt whether he'd like to have them in public anyway.
Anyway.
At this stage. Yeah.
All right, well, we'll leave it there. Thanks for joining us today, and I hope I did Stephen justice and did my best. So,
yeah, thank you.
Thank you, darling.